I'm John with Roundabout Woodworks, and in today's video I'm going to show you how to harness the power of firewood using this. This is a piece of oak. It's a little bit longer than firewood, but that's because I don't cut firewood, I cut turning wood. This is approximately, it's about a fat 3.5 inches across, and it's as long as my arm. There is some checking on the end, and I'm going to cut that off. And I will show you how I turn this into the blanks, and then from the blanks into a pair of matching candlesticks. If you don't have access to green wood, you can buy the wood you need for this project. You need to start with a 3/4 inch board, 3.5 inches wide at least. You'll need 2 squares, 3.5 inch square by 3/4 inch thick, and you'll need 12 inch length of 1.5 or 2 inch square, whatever you got. I would suggest you not do this if you've never made candlesticks and you don't have a lot of experience duplicating. Then I would suggest you do not use expensive wood. Don't use some exotic that cost you $40. Just use whatever you can find. If you have access to pallets, then you're golden because you have basically all the stock you need for candlesticks. As I say in all my videos, you do not need a chuck to do this. The only part that you would, I'm going to use a chuck because I like using the chuck. It makes things so much simpler, so much easier. Really the only hard part without a chuck would be the base, and you can do that with a glue block and a faceplate. You could even do a kind of sort of screw chuck by running a long wood screw through the center of a faceplate mounted, or center of a flat piece of wood mounted on your faceplate. That'll give you something to screw the base blank to, and then there's your center mark for your hole that you're going to have to drill to mount the spindle part. So you can do it without a chuck. I'm going to use a chuck. You will also, if you want to do it all on the lathe, you will need a Jacob's chuck mounted in an appropriate center for your lathe. You can do it on a drill press. You can do it freehand. There's ways of doing everything I do in a different way. You know, they always say there's more than one way of doing something. I'm just going to do it my way, the way that I have evolved, I guess, into doing it. I do have a special drill bit that I use to drill the pockets. You don't actually even need to do this. I took a spade bit. Let's see that. It's just a spade bit. It was a 7/8 diameter spade bit, and I ground a taper on the end down to 3/4 of an inch. Polish the edges so it doesn't scrape an out of round hole, but not on the ground part. The ground part needs to be sharp so that it can cut in at a taper. The top part, you want that to be more or less rounded, so or dull, so it doesn't scrape out a really wide hole. Believe it or not, candles come in different sizes. Tapered candles, like you know, dinner over candlelight, they come. I've seen them myself in 1/2 inch, 5/8, 3/4, and inch diameter. So, if you don't have any candles in your house, go buy some candles and then measure those for the pockets. And there will be enough room to play using this design so that you can put anything. You could probably, I was going to say you could put a tea light in the top of them, but these aren't going to be big enough for a tea light. But you could do that. You can modify the design. It should look fine scaled up or down. It's going to be a couple of beads and a taper and maybe some V-cuts. The base is going to be rather plain, but still elegant. And so, you know, you could drill a straight 7/8 inch for a 3/4 inch candle. You can just drill your average 3/4 inch candle, because some of them are not average. But for the average 3/4 inch tapered dinner type candle, a 7/8 hole will work. A 3/4 inch straight hole will work, but the candle won't fit all the way into the pocket. But it'll hold up at least long enough for dinner. While I'm thinking about it, candlesticks are flammable, and I am not using the little brass pockets that you can buy because they are outrageously expensive, and I just don't think that's right. So I'm not going to buy any. I'm not going to use them. I like being able to do the entire design the way I want it to look without being subjected to the diameters of some add-on piece. But if you've seen my video, Will It Burn?, that you know that candlesticks will catch fire, they will burn. You could conceivably burn your house down by leaving a candle burning unattended, so don't ever do that. Anyway, that's my safety bit for today. So, I don't think I've left anything out. If I have, I'll be sure to mention it during the turning process. So, enjoy the video. I know that oak checks about that far, generally. Maybe a little bit further. You know, as years go by, it gets deeper and deeper, but this hasn't been sitting in the shop for very long. So, what I'm going to do is saw the end off until I don't see... I don't know if you can see. You can't see that. There's some checking. There's a check right here that goes down. I'm just going to saw the end of it off until I get to unchecked wood. And then I'm going to saw off a couple of squares. And then I'm going to saw off a length for the upright. So that's what we're going to do. I'm not using the right blade, but I really don't feel like changing the blade. I'm just going to go slow and it'll cut. Split that down the middle. I'm not going to saw it. And, so this is the these are the pieces that we need for candlesticks. That's not what we need. I'm going to leave that there. Rough center. Now I've got a drive center mounted in the lathe. Put that on center. It doesn't have to be perfect because you're going to turn away most of this. And then run up your tailstock. Doing that by eye. Close enough. And the reason I run my tailstock up so much, or so far out, is because my tool rest is too long to fit between there. So I need the clearance for my tool rest, that's all. All right, first thing I'm gonna do is I'm gonna turn a tenon on this side so that I can grab it in the chuck to turn this side. You'll see how I'm doing it. If you don't have a glue block, I mean, if you don't have a chuck, then what you'd probably wanna do is run this on your sander, or if you're reasonably skilled with a plane, you could plane this flat. But as you see, it's rough split, it's not flat. So I don't want to glue this to a glue block, but that's what you would have to do. You'd make this flat, give you a flat surface so that you can glue it to a glue block, and then you can turn the entire thing from one side and then pry it off your glue block, and you'll have the base. But I'm going to do it, you'll see, it's basically the hard way, but it feels like it's less work. So, okay, I'm also, for this, going to be using a bowl gouge with an Irish grind. That's just because that's what I'm comfortable using. There's no other reason for it. All right, here we go. Just want to hold it. Alright, so I turned a tenon on both of them. I now have a chuck, and this chuck has 2-inch jaws, 50 millimeter jaws, so that's about how big the tenon is. I think it's 2 1/4, 2 1/8. It's not critical, it's temporary. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to flatten the face and turn the diameter down to 3 1/2, because that's what I want, and turn a recess for the chuck jaws and flip it over and turn the top. And I'm not sure I can show you everything with the camera being where it is. I may have to get creative with camera angles, so I'll be back. I think you can see all right. I'm still using a bowl gouge with an Irish grind. I can use a traditional grind. Yeah, let's switch it up. Let's use traditional grind for a while. That is not critical. See if I can turn this one without getting my beard in the way. Let the camera run. Thank you. doesn't matter. Whatever you want to use. Inch Forstner bit. The reason I use a Forstner bit is because it's easier to get a diameter with these junky calipers that I've got. So I drill the hole with that bit, I take the diameter off the bit, turn the tenon on the spindle, and they fit together really nice. So that's what I'm going to do. Structural. You're not going to be holding up beams with it. It's a candle. So, you can go all the way through if you want. I like to leave a little mystery on the bottom. Stupid, I know. Alright. So in your duplicating, what do you do when you mess one up? Well, you make the best of it, and then you can go back on the other one and fix it. So now I have two, I don't know if you can see that. What happened was one of them was wound up thinner along this edge than the other. So I went ahead and finished that one up and then put the first one back on and made it the same. I made it the same thickness. They're both the same height, same thickness. I mean, within thousandths, you know. You can't feel the difference. And you can barely see the difference. You have to look really hard and just the right angle to see the difference. But, I mean, they're essentially the same. This is hand turned. This is not push a button and have one pop out, you know. This is hand turned. It should look not imperfect, but it shouldn't look machine made. Make it as nice as you can, and you'll get the right effect. And I may ebonize these. I'm thinking about ebonizing them. I made a lamp recently, and I ebonized it and painted some gold details on it, and it's really pretty. So I may do that with a candlestick, maybe not. I don't know. We'll see. So I said I was going to show you, but come on. Actually, I forgot and figured you wouldn't hold it against me. So how do you find center on a quarter of a log? Well, believe it or not, if you just eyeball it, it's usually close enough. And, you know, you can measure with your... Because I'm not going to... And remember, this is... You can't even see what I'm talking about. This is going to be gone. So your diameter is not between here and here. This is going to go away too. But your diameter is between here and here. So let's just eyeball this. That's close enough. And ideally, I will have... Yeah, that should be enough. All right, and duplicating. What I'm going to do next is draw a plan on camera so that you can see. What I'm not going to do is turn one and then say, "Wow, that looks really nice. I'll do it again." Because you'll have a slight difference in your piece. If you turn one, and I do this often, if you turn one until you find the shape that you like, and you're not aiming to create a finished piece at that point, you're just hunting for a shape. You turn one that you really like the shape, and then turn your duplicates from that one, and they'll be the same. It's amazing how close you can get. It's mostly muscle memory, so I think that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to charge my camera because the battery is going dead, and I'm going to draw out the plan on camera after that and show you how to turn two of something somehow. I realize I just turned two of something, and you're probably no better off than you were before, but I'm working on it. Alright, I'm going to rough this to round using my favorite tool and yours, 3/4 inch skew.
Normally I'm a little closer to the, trying to do it on camera so you can see. A little awkward. So I got some cambium layer that's going to have to come off. Excuse me, but there's no cracks or splits. So this is a good piece of wood. And I said I was going to draw it on camera, but I didn't. Because I didn't want y'all to think I was some kind of artist or anything. This is my plan. Obviously the base is here. That's the base. It's going to be a bead here, and a slight taper there. And I say slight because it's elongated. If it was a severe taper, it would be over the space of an inch, but this is a long taper. Duh. I'm telling you what you already know. Alright, first thing I'm going to do, inch and a quarter major diameter. Got my caliper here. Yeah. 16th off the diameter. And right here, I'm a 16th off the diameter for the taper. So you have to be careful and not mess it up. And I'm just, right now I'm checking by eye, looking to see what it looks like. I suppose that's okay. Candlesticks. And even though I'd made a drawing, I'd never made this shape in a candlestick before. I've done lots of beads, lots of tapers, lots of balls, but never all together in one shape or one item. So they are very slightly different. The bead is slightly narrower on the one to my left on this one. The top bead is a bit thinner than the other one, but almost imperceptibly. The ball at the bottom, it's difficult to see probably. It's a little more squashed on this stick. And I drilled them on the drill press and did what I do all too frequently. I didn't line it up exactly right, and the hole is slightly off center on this one. And if you look at it just right, there's a little bit of light coming through where the drill pushed through this bead groove. So what that means is that this is a fatal flaw. They will go into the house instead of into the store. Anyway, I think it's a pretty simple shape, and I think you ought to be able to do this. I hope you try. Candlesticks are fun. They will catch fire if you let a candle burn down into the pocket. I did make a video where I show it. I never believed that it would happen. And I thought, well, candle, how much heat can there be? But yeah, it happened. And I would advise you to watch my video if you don't think I'm telling you the truth. Anyway, these are the candlesticks. I hope that you found the video entertaining, educational. I hope that when I finally get through editing it, it's not unwatchable. I really don't like editing video. I'm not very good at it. Anyway, I want to say thank you to all my subscribers, which, by the way, I have hit 5,000 subscribers, and I'm humbled. So if you're not a subscriber, be part of the crowd, I suppose. Anyway, thanks for all the likes, the shares, and especially for the subscriptions. Make some candlesticks and see me in the next video. Thanks.